Look into my eyes, you will see what you mean to me. Search your heart, search your soul, and when you find me there, you'll search no more. Don't tell me it's not worth trying for. You can't tell me it's not worth dying for. You know it's true, everything I do it for you. Your heart, you will find there's nothing there to hide. Take me as I am, take my life. I would give it all, I would sacrifice. Don't tell do it for you. When the rain is blowing in your face and the whole world is on your case, I could offer you a warm embrace to make you feel my love. When the evening shatters and the stars appear, there is no one there to dry your tears. I could hold you for a million years to make you feel my love. I know you haven't made your mind up yet, but I would never do you wrong. I go hungry, I go black and blue, I go crawling down the come true. Nothing that I wouldn't do. Go to the ends of the earth for you, to make you feel my love, to make you feel my love.
thank you for coming today to this special ceremony. I remind you too that not only is this a ceremony of love and marriage, but it's a worship service to our Lord and Savior. So with that respect, and the respect and worship that this deserves, we do ask you not to take any more flesh during this time until the bride and groom get back the aisle again. Christian friends, we are assembled here in the sight of God to unite Carrie and Kelly in Christian marriage. Marriage is established by God, blessed by our Lord Jesus Christ, and to be honored by us. God has created and sanctified marriage for our welfare and our happiness. Jesus said that we should leave our father and mother and be joined in marriage. Shall we pray? Let us pray. Gracious God, we feel that today this love and deep relationships are at the very center of a meaningful life. And Carrie and Kelly have found that their love for each other is so great that they wish to commit themselves to each other in marriage. Let your holy presence fill and enrich this service of celebration and commitment, as well as their whole life together. We invite your blessing, O God, upon this service and upon the marriage of Kelly and Carrie. Amen. And who gives this young lady in marriage? The couple has chosen two readings at this time from the scriptures. The first one, an Old Testament reading, and Greg will read that one. And the second one, a reading from Paul's epistle to the Colossians, a New Testament reading, and Megan will read that one.
A reading from Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verses 9 through 12. Two are better than one, for if they fall, one will lift up his companion. But woe to him who is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him up. If two lie down together, they will keep warm. How can one be warm alone? Though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him. A cord of three strands is not quickly.
As God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace. Be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him.
Carrie and Kelly, I asked for a few minutes here that I could share some scriptures with you, talk to you about marriage. And you graciously said yes. You couldn't have done otherwise. So if you're going to be married here, I'm going to talk to you a little bit. And I'm going to talk to all of you as well. I'm going to read a passage of scripture. These are words from our Lord Jesus himself. In Mark's gospel, it's recorded, and he tells us about marriage, how marriage started, and what it means. And here are his words. But at the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. Or as the translation that we're used to hearing, let no man put asunder, let no one separate. This particular passage of scripture tells us that marriage is not a human invention. It tells us at the very beginning, that's what it says, but at the very beginning, God created human beings. He created them male and female. And he breathed his own life into them, his own breath. He didn't do that to any of the other creatures out there that he made, although I'm sure he lovingly made them. To human beings, he breathed his own breath into them. And he made them male and female. You are essentially different, yet a counterpart of each other. You complete each other. You complete each other mentally, emotionally, physically. God made you the way he made you. And he made you and he made all of us. He designed us this way. He designed us that we could indeed enjoy the marriage relationship and complement someone else. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife. To leave father and mother. What is happening here today in this marriage ceremony is that a new home is being established. That's what a marriage ceremony is designed to show. A new home is being established. It's your home. It's not somebody else's home. Your marriage isn't going to look just like your neighbor's marriage. It's your marriage. And your guests, your parents will be guests in your home because it's your home and your marriage. Your partner may be slightly different than you, and already you know that. But those differences are just differences. They're neither right or wrong. They're just different. And so you need to be patient and caring with each other. The Bible passage here says that you become one. It's a divine miracle. God does something here. He is present here. You're saying your vows before witnesses and before God. God is doing something here. He's making you one. And it's also an ongoing effort that you do. You learn to live in harmony with someone who is very different from you. Carrie, you're about to become a husband. You've never been a husband before, but you're going to be one today. And from now on, you're going to be one. And your job is not to make her different. Your job is to love her and to cherish her and to care for her. Kelly, you're about to become a wife. Never been a wife before. But you're going to be one today, and from now on you will be. And your job isn't to make him different. Make him over, although you will try many times. He won't succeed. Your job is to honor him, respect him, to love him, and sometimes care for him when he needs something extra to care for, somebody to care for him. The husband and wife role is indeed a privilege, but it's also an obligation. As we look at this oneness that Jesus describes here, I just want to admonish you to do those things that build up love. A marriage relationship is a sacred and protected relationship. And love can grow strong in that relationship, provided you stay loyal to your vows, faithful to each other. Do that, and your marriage relationship will be strong. Listen to each other. Take time for each other. Practice ongoing romance. Pray and serve God together. God is the glue that holds you together. Avoid those things that destroy love. Selfish things. Painful things. Calling each other names. Long silences. The death look. Or whatever it might be. Foolishness. Don't spend money on things that your partner doesn't know about. The teasing. The carelessness. The cutting remarks. Don't tell lies. Don't go places that your partner doesn't know you're going. Oneness is living in harmony. If you do these things, your home will be safe. And if you keep these vows and God blesses your home with children, your children will grow up in a safe and secure home. Just starting today, this is your wedding day. A year from now, you will be married 1 year. It'll be your first anniversary. 2 years from now, your second anniversary. Someday, it will be your 25th anniversary and your 35th. And maybe even your 50th anniversary and beyond. And you'll look around and you'll look at all those young punks, and they won't, you'll know more about love than they've ever even thought about. Because that's what happens as we go through life. We learn to live in harmony, and we learn to love each other deeply. Let's listen now as our couple exchanges their wedding vows. Would you step forward, please, and face each other? You need to listen carefully to the vows you're saying to each other. You're making solemn promises. Listen to the promises you're making. I, Carrie, take you, Kelly.
I, Carrie, take you, Kelly.
To be my wedded wife.
To be my wedded wife.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
And to be faithful to you alone.
And to be faithful to you alone.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
According to God's holy plan.
According to God's holy plan.
Kelly, here's your vow. I, Kelly, take you, Carrie.
I, Kelly, take you, Carrie.
To be my wedded husband.
To be my wedded husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
And to be faithful to you alone.
And to be faithful to you alone.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
According to God's holy plan.
According to God's holy plan.
Could we have the rings, please? Now, the wedding ring has long been a symbol of married love. It's made in a perfect circle to show us that love goes on and on and on and on. It never ends. And it's made of the finest of metals to show us of the highest ideals, that of married love. Kelly, Carrie. Carrie, as a sign of your love for Kelly, would you place the ring on her finger, please? And Kelly, as a sign of your love for Carrie, would you do the same? Behind us on the altar table is a unity candle. We've seen those at wedding ceremonies too. They symbolize what I've read about two becoming one. You sing for us. Following the lighting of the unity candle, there'll be gifts to the parents. Carrie and Kelly, you've made solemn vows here today before God and before all these witnesses. I charge you to keep those vows. Keep them safe. Keep them secure. Keep your promises. And now you've made this solemn commitment of marriage before God and before all of us. I now declare you as a minister of the gospel to be a husband and wife. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Shall we bow in prayer? O God in heaven, we thank you that you have set us in families, binding us together by sacred and tender ties. We pray that Kelly and Carrie, who have just pledged themselves to each other, may experience your blessing. May these outward acts result in the true union of hearts and lives. And may your love make sacred the love they feel. In the name of our Lord Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Carrie, you may kiss your bride. First time, Mr. and Mrs. Carey Roberts.
Thank you. necessary for me.